We have two forms of electricity. The first kind is DC, or direct current. Okay, this is a steady, unchanging voltage and current on a line. It's 5 volts, it's 10 volts, it's 12 volts, it's 15, and it never changes. It just stays at that same value. Okay, then we have AC, or alternating current. Okay, and this is the kind that we use mostly. It's a constantly changing, constantly cycling or oscillating voltage or current. Okay. And we'll see exactly how that works in a second here. Now, we have these aspects of electricity. There are four of them. The first one is voltage. And this is the electrical pressure that's present in a system, the amount of voltage that's there, how much charge is there. It's the strength of the charge. This is what causes current to flow. You have to have a voltage present in order for current to flow. Okay? It's measured in volts. And it can be either AC or DC. There can be AC voltages and there can be DC voltages. And if you're just writing about it in a paragraph for text, you use the letter V. If you're working math equations, then you use the letter E. But you guys won't be working any math equations. But there is that designation, V for text, E for math. Okay. And we have current. Now, this is the movement of electrons, but it's mostly the movement of the charge in the conductor. Okay. It happens with a complete path, okay? If you have a battery, there's voltage present on those terminals of the battery, but there is no current flowing because there is no circuit or circle of electricity. So you can have something where voltage is present, like a battery, but there is no current present there because there is no circuit connecting the plus and minus together. There has to be a circuit for current to flow and for current to be present. So it is possible to have voltage without current, okay? It's mostly what we would call static electricity, you know? The kid with the charged particles are there, but there's no circuit, you know? If you were to walk across the room and touch ground or something, you get that little spark. We've all felt that on a doorknob. That's what makes the circuit. Electricity goes into whatever it is, the ground or whatever, and it makes the path. Current is said to flow in a circuit. And when there's that complete path, then current flows. It's measured in amperes, or what we call amps. And it can be either AC or DC quantity. There are AC amps and there are DC amps. We'll use A for a text designation. You're just writing about it, like 600 amps or whatever. And we'll use I for math equations. So when you see I, that's current. Okay. The next aspect is resistance. All right. Now, resistance is the opposition to current flow. When you plug something in to the wall or to a battery, it resists that electricity. It pushes back on that electricity. It's the opposition to current flow. Okay? It's always present in a conductor. As we saw, some conductors are better than others. Silver has very low resistance. Tap water has very high resistance. Okay? It turns the electricity into heat. That's what it does. Electricity tries to push against it, resistance pushes back, heat results. Okay, so it converts the electricity to heat. It's measured in ohms, and it uses the omega symbol for text designation. You'll see like 25 omega, that's ohms. And then R is used for math equations. So you'll see, you know, 25 R is resistance. Okay. The last aspect is power. Okay. Now, power is the energy dissipated in a circuit. This is actually the amount of work that's getting done. It's also the rate at which energy is consumed in a circuit. And you'll see this. Something has so many watts, 60-watt light, 100-watt light, whatever. It's the rate at which energy is consumed by that device. It's measured in watts. That was the guy's name that discovered that property. It can be either AC or DC quantity, okay? And W is used if you're just writing about it in a text, like a paragraph, and then you'll see P is used for math equations. So you'll probably see W a lot more because you'll see, you know, something it'll say 450 W, that stands for watts. Okay. Now, we'll get into a couple of useful electrical terms here. The first one is source, all right? This is where the electricity is from. This is where it is sourced. I had to come up with a different word, you know. But that's where the electricity is from. And then you have the load, and that's where the electricity is put. You're taking the source, and you're putting it across the load, okay? The load is a resistance over here. That resistance, if it's high, it's pushing back on that source. It doesn't want electricity to flow. If the resistance is low, then it lets more electricity go through it. Okay. Circuit, that's the complete path or circle of electricity. That's what's called a circuit. And you can see here that you have your source and your load and your circuit. Okay. It's DC, just one circle there. Okay. Now, other useful terms here, positive. That's the source of electricity. We're talking mostly DC, all right? Then we have negative or neutral, that's where the destination is, okay? And you have ground. These are the three symbols for ground. This is earth ground, which is the earth, the actual earth that we walk in on, excuse me. this is what's known as chassis ground, which is the physical cases and things of the devices that we plug in. And then this is signal ground. This is an audio thing, okay? These things may or may not all be connected together, but there are different kinds of ground. There's physical ground, there's chassis ground, there's signal ground. There's all these different kinds of grounds. And they may be connected, they may not be connected, okay? But as a general term, ground is the earth for electricity, and that's what we're going to talk about. It can be either positive or negative in DC. So you can have a negative ground in DC or you can have a positive ground in DC. Okay? The reason why ground is important is that's where the voltages are measured from. That's your 0 volt reference. When you see something is 5 volts, you're measuring from ground. It's 5 volts with respect to ground. Just as someone is 6 feet with respect to the earth. They're 6 feet, you know, they're 6 feet tall. Well, where are you measuring from? The ground, it's flat, it, you know, that's zero, this is, you know, 5'10". So how do these aspects work together? You have your voltage and pressure, which is pushing out from where you're sourcing it, and then you have this resistance to it, the opposition, okay? That's what's pushing back. So where you have a source voltage and it meets a low load resistance, you get more current flowing, because there's less resistance to that electricity. More current flows in that circuit. Consequently, you're using more power, okay? Lower resistance, you can push more power across that circuit, okay? You have a similar situation where you have that same source voltage and it encounters a greater opposition, okay? A higher resistance, more opposition. So when your source voltage meets more load resistance, then less current flows in that circuit. Okay? Consequently, less power is used. Okay? We're going to look at direct current a little bit. Direct current is a fixed polarity and orientation, positive and negative. It can be either positive or negative orientation. You can have plus 5 volts, you can have minus 5 volts. It all depends on what you select as ground. If you ground the positive, then you got negative voltages. If you ground the negative, then you have positive voltages. Okay? It's constant. It never changes. It's 5 volts, it's 10 volts, it's 20 volts, you know, 9 volt battery, it's 9 volts, okay, all the time. It's used in cars and boats and aircraft a lot, portable stuff. And it's also used a lot in audio, video, computers, and now some of the newer lights are DC, okay. Basically, it's a battery, is direct current. Negative and positive charge on that battery, okay. So, this is another DC circuit here. You can see you get positive and everything. There's our circuit. And off we go. Now, if you look at it on a graph, you can see that you've got a constant unchanging voltage there. It could be plus 5, plus 12, plus 15. This is DC volts. It never changes. It just goes right on out with time. If you look at it on this graph, which is very similar, you have a 0 volt reference. That's ground. You can have plus voltages, which are above ground, but you can also have minus voltages, which are below ground, depending on how you orient your power supply, okay? So you'll see sometimes power supplies will be plus 5 volt power supplies, or they'll be minus 5 volt power supplies. Your computer at home actually uses plus 5, plus 12, and minus 5, and minus 12. And some of them even use plus and minus 15. That's why I included those three values. It could be anything. It could be 9, it could be 30, and, you know. But if you look on your computer power supply at home, it takes AC and converts it to DC. And it uses a lot of these plus and minus voltages to run all the chips and everything inside your computer that you have at home. There's some advantages to direct current, which are pretty good. The circuits can be very simple. They're usually very, very simple circuits. They're easy to understand and implement. It's easy to use DC, real direct. It's portable, you know, take it anywhere. Portable tools. It's usually low voltage and current, so it's pretty safe. You know, what's in your car is 12 volts DC. You're not going to get shocked off a car battery, you know. You could get burned. That's a different issue. But the voltage itself is so low voltage, you could stick your fingers across it, and you're not going to get shocked. It's just too low voltage. You can recharge it, which is a great advantage to DC. It recharges very easily. And there are many devices that can run on DC, you know. We all have lots of devices. That camera runs on DC, this computer runs on DC, phone runs on DC, lots and lots of things run on DC. And it's clean, it's very clean power, you know. That's what's nice about DC, is it's very hard to corrupt DC. Some disadvantages to DC is you can only use it for a short distance, so you're not gonna get it to front of house to power things. It's good for about maybe 25, 30 feet. Maybe 50, that's about it, you know. You lose, the amount of wire that it takes to get DC across a stage is considerable, and you'll lose it all in the wire under resistance, and we'll see that later. It's really hard to step it up or down DC, very, very difficult. Compared to AC, it's really complicated, and that's what makes DC very inefficient, because it's fine if you have a 12-volt device and a 12-volt supply, you're good. If you have a 12-volt device and a 5-volt supply, and you have to go from 5 up to 12, then you're in a world of hurt, because it's very difficult to step that 5 volts up to 12 volts DC. You need special, you know, inverters, and they use power, and it, you know, it's just a nightmare, okay? You're limited by the battery size that you have, you know? How much power you have is how big a battery you have. This is what is limiting electric cars. Is AC. You know, you need AC to run motors, but the only thing you can store is DC charges, and that's what's limiting electric cars right now, okay, is this issue. You can't use it for chain motors. It just doesn't work. It's not enough power. The wires have to be too thick. The motors are too big. It just, DC chain motors just don't work. They're used for some industrial applications, but we'll never see them, you know. And it's very hard to control. DC is very hard to control compared to AC. A lot of these things are advantages that AC has, which is why we use AC for so many things. And some devices just flat out won't run on it, you know. Chain motors is a prime example of that. What we use it for is power supplies for computers. LED lighting is DC. On the inside, it's running on DC. Audio amps, consoles, processors, those are all DC devices, you know. Yes, they plug into the wall, but they have power supplies that convert the AC down to DC, and that's what runs them. Video cameras, lighting controls, those are all DC devices, okay? Transportation and batteries, golf cart batteries, you know, those are all DC. Voltage reference is a little bit obscure. There are certain devices out there that need a constant voltage reference in order to function properly. And control voltages for digital devices, those are all DC too. And portable tools are also DC, little screw guns and all of that stuff. So what we get into is what we use mostly, and what the class is about, is alternating current. Now, alternating current can be stepped down, up or down really easily. You run it through a transformer, you step it up, or you run it through a transformer, you step it down. It's very efficient. You can go from 120 volts up to 300. You can take 120 down to 6 volts. You just get a transformer, run it through that transformer. You can step it up or down. It's very efficient. Works really well. You can vary it easily in small increments, which is something that's really hard to do with DC, and it's much more efficient to do it with AC. You can run AC for really long distances, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and thousands of feet for AC without losing it, okay? It's the standard everywhere across the country, you know, which is really nice. It's very efficient. You can have plenty of power available to it, and almost anything we have will run on it. Just about everything we have will run on AC. And it's easily isolated between lighting, sound, and video, and that's important. And we'll go over that if we have time later on when we're looking at sound power. Now, there are some disadvantages to AC. Mostly it's pretty high voltage and current, so it's dangerous. Okay, where we're running it, we're doing these 120 volt and 208 volt systems. That's a lot of voltage. And if it isn't handled properly, that is enough to kill you. And it doesn't take much electricity to go through your heart and stop it. Okay, so it is dangerous. You can't run portable devices on AC because you can't store AC in a battery. You can only store DC in a battery. And it's subject to swings in level and quality. That's another disadvantage of it. It's not real clean power, and you're kind of beholden to the power company. And most of our theaters, this isn't a problem. Down in Canton, it's an issue. And I'll talk about the Canton Civic Center because it can get to be a real nightmare down there for power. Their electricity is not good there. And Julie can probably tell you a little bit more about that. Right, Julie?
You have a good handle on it.
Yeah. AC, the AC at the Canton Civic Center is very bad for us. It's easily corrupted. You know, a motor turns on somewhere, it sends a spike through your system. Coffee machine turns on somewhere, you get noise and audio, you know. Controlling it can create problems, and we'll see some of that when it gets into audio. That's mostly an audio issue. And sometimes you don't have enough. You know, if you've ever been on and out where there's a power failure, it's really a bummer. You know, you're trying to get these chain motors out of the ceiling and you don't have any power. And you got to, you know, this happened once at Blossom where they had to get the generator in there or hook that all up. You know, it was like this nightmare, you know. So you're kind of beholden to the power company, and sometimes you don't have enough of it to do what you want to do because there could be a power failure, you know. What we use it for is lighting, sound, and video, okay? We use it for chain motors because we have to. Basically, anything we plug into the wall is running on AC. Audio signals are AC. I don't know if you're aware of that. DMX control signals for lighting are also AC. That's an AC wave that's going through there. Radio signals, radios that we have, you know, those are AC. Wi-Fi signals for computers, that's all AC. And video signals are all AC as well. I can tell you about that. So when you look at an AC on a graph, and we're going to get into a little bit of this, it looks like this on a graph. Starts off at zero here, and it swings positive, then it swings negative, and then positive and negative, and positive and negative, and positive. It's just continually alternating between positive and negative. That's what we call alternating current, okay? The distance between any two of the same point is called the period, okay? And that's the time it takes, the same point on the cycle. And the frequency, what they call the frequency, that's the rate at which these oscillations occur per second. So in the United States, we use 60 cycle AC. That means that this wave, That means that this wave is oscillating up and down from here to there, which is one cycle. It's doing that 60 times per second. Up and down, 60 times per second. That's what we call 60 cycle. Other countries are on 50 cycle, okay? Mostly because 50 is divisible into 100. That's the best I can do for you. Okay. The United Kingdom, Europe, China, they're all on 50 cycle power, and I believe Japan is on 50 cycle power. So we're kind of alone in the world in terms of 60 cycle. When that was established way back in the 19th century, they determined that 60 cycle was the best, and it's never been changed. Now, if you look at an AC waveform in a 60th of a second, it looks like this, okay? You can see where the voltage starts here at zero, and then it swings all the way up here, goes back to zero, all the way negative, and goes back to here. These numbers here are the cycles from 1 to 360. So those are the number of degrees that that thing is going through. And this is voltage over here. This is zero, that's up to 200 negative. 200 positive, 200 negative. This is voltage, this measurement from top to bottom. And this is time, okay, or degrees, you know, however you want to look at it. Now, this is our zero volt reference right in the middle here. These are positive voltage, it swings positive. And then it swings negative down there.